You know, this is supposed to be very informal. Jenny reminded me, this is not a seminar. Okay, it's not a presentation. It's called story time, okay? Shawnee story. So that means there'll be interaction. And my point for today is to go through and just talk about some of the memories that I've had over the years as it relates to growing up in this area and as it relates to the swimming hole off of 125, right off 52, to the Trout Derby, to Boy Scout Camp, moving on up to Turkey Creek Lake, coming here to the lodge. So that's where we're going to start. I grew up on Carey's Run, and we're going to start there. But if I hit some memory that you may have had, please share that with us. If you steal much of my time, I'll cut you off, okay? It makes me a little bit nervous because I didn't realize in the beginning that we were actually going to be videoing this for future generations. And so we have Justin here from Canaan Valley. He represents, what's it called, Justin? U.S. Hotels?
Yes,
USA?
Yes, sir. U.S. Hotels.
Okay. And so he is here, and a friend of mine, Donnie Locke, is a videographer, also recording this. So thank you for coming. Normally we have about, in these story times, I've only been to one, and that was one that Drew Fight did on the Underground Railroad. And so normally I think there's just a small group. This is a nice group. I'm not sure why you're all here. Well, it was either my name or it's like, oh, we're going to get to see something about the lodge. We talked about doing this for many years. I've talked to Lisa over the years. I've talked to Jenny. And to my knowledge, I have the only video of the lodge being built. My dad had the foresight to take an 8mm camera and record some of the early work that was done here. He had the site work. And so we're going to lead up to that and show his video. You got to remember, this is 1971 time frame. His videographer experience was not that great. And so we're going to be watching some old films. Come on in. We've got seats on the couch and up front here.
You don't care if I sit on the couch, do you?
Hey, I want you to sit right here close because I'm going to be introducing this guy later. And we'll be telling some stories about him as well. He doesn't get an introduction just yet. We got to wait for the right time. Anyway, I have the only video. If anyone has a video or pictures of the lodge in the early days of it being built, Jenny and Lisa would really be thrilled to have that because we have found that it's hard to find pictures. I want to give thanks to Drew Fight, who was able to go out and find some articles from the Portsmouth Times of the lodge being built. And we have pictures by the famous photographer, Billy Graham. And so those are back on the table. Afterwards, you can mill around and look at that. I was able to also get some pictures from the Altman Company. Altman Cody built the lodge. And I thought, I wonder if they're still in business. And so what we did is I looked them up, and they're now called the Altman Company. I talked to Norm Altman, the owner, and he sent some brochures and some pictures. He thought it was really neat that we're actually doing this. And so that was being passed around here. That's a brochure that he sent. Yeah, here we go. This is being passed around. Look at that. The Altman Company is a pretty big company. They're out of Columbus, Ohio. And they built places like Lazarus and over in Eastland. And so we had, this was in their early days. And he was nice enough to send us this information. It's an old brochure, but it has the lodge in here, something that they were promoting as the type of work that they do. Oh, raise my voice a little bit more. Okay. Hey, but I have a lapel mic on. Okay. So remember, this is story time, and I'm going to start. I was raised on Carey's Run. How many of you know where Carey's Run is? How many of you are from this area? All right. So in Carrie's run, as a kid, we were sort of in between. You either went to Nauvoo or you went to Friendship. And we were always torn and drawn between the two. I played Little League Baseball in Friendship, okay? And so I spent a lot of time in this area. To give you an idea how old I am, I missed it by 1 year of attending a one-room schoolhouse on Carrie's Run. They didn't have kindergarten then. But I ended up going to a Nauvoo, not Friendship. So we were in between. Baseball, we had to go to Friendship. When I played baseball at Friendship, I played for Pyatt Funeral Home. We played behind the old Friendship School, you know, across from the church, right really close to the largest buckeye tree in the state. We also played at Schwamberger Field down in Friendship. Some people that you might know that was on my baseball team was Terry and Jerry Easter, Roger Davis, at third base. Those guys were pitcher, catcher, and first base. No one could beat us because those three were so good. The rest of us just hung out in the field. But we had Colin Fannin on third base, Mark Price at shortstop, Mark Price second base, Tim Price at second base, Mark Perry at shortstop, and then the outfielders, we had a guy named Spencer, and the rest of us were bench warmers. We got sent out every couple innings or so. When I think about, it mentioned in the write-up that I was from Carrie's Run and hiked at Raven Rock. If you notice the big mural in here of Raven Rock, it makes me remember about as a kid, we would always go to Raven Rock and hike up there many different ways. But how many remember the county infirmary? So we would come down by the county infirmary, always a bunch of men standing around, very old in my eyes at that time. And we would stop and visit them on our way to Raven Rock. One of the other stops we would do would be at the dog pound. Do you know where the dog pound was?
Yes.
Now, I probably shouldn't tell this, but I will. As kids, we didn't like it that the dogs went through different stages before they were put to sleep. They only kept them so long. We had a fellow named Carl Wakers. He was a little skinny fellow. And so what we would do is take Carl Wakers and drop him down into the first unit there where the dogs are kept. And he would begin handing dogs up to us so we would release them. That was an event on our way to Raven Rock. And so when these are the kind of memories that run through my mind, the kind of things that we did. The first church I ever went to was Bethel, right there below Raven Rock. Ed and Carol Cunningham were our neighbors, and she took me to church, Vacation Bible School. We went to Raven Rock Drag Strip on Saturday nights. We would save our money because it cost $2 to get into the pit area. If you're going to go to Raven Rock, that's where you want to be, in the pit area. Sometimes they raced on Sunday afternoons. We would go to Raven Rock and watch them, but you really couldn't see anything. They were just like little specks. So it wasn't really, we had a great idea, but it wasn't that great of an idea because you could hardly see anything. And then we roller skated at Raven Rock Roller Rink. So that's my life on Carrie's Run. Now I'm going to work down 52, and as we move up 52, we come to the swimming hole. Who has ever gone to the swimming hole just a quarter mile up on the left off 52? You've swum on 125. You have? Raise your hands if you swam in that. Isn't that amazing? CB, you swam in it? Aren't you a Portsmouth boy? And you come out of the city to do that. Now, what we said, we were swimming in the creek.
Yep.
But then I married a girl from the city, and she told me it was a creek. How many of you remember when you'd pull your car into the creek or creek to wash it? You had running water, right? And you had everything you needed to clean your car and pull it back out. The other correction I had is I used to wash my car, now I wash it. These things happen as you age, you're corrected on how we speak. How many of you called it a crick? So I'm not alone. How many washed versus wash? This is great, Ed, because I got people that agree with me. What did they call that swimming hole? I've heard, I didn't even know it had a name until I talked to Jenny. What was it?
The bathtub.
Yeah, that's what I
The tub, the bathtub. I never knew that until just recently. Now as we move on up, there's Camp Oyo. My great memories of Camp Oyo, I went there in the wintertime with our scout troop. I went in the summertime. In the summertime, my grandmother, Edry Brooks, was a cook there. She stayed in the cook's cabin. Now, it's nice having your grandmother as a cook. In the summertime, you go for a whole week. And when you went through the chow line, guess who got more than everybody else? And it was my first experience of eating cinnamon sugar toast. I always got two pieces, everyone else got one. The other thing I think about on Scout Camp is Camp Jamboree. I remember all the different competitions. I loved the one where they give you a compass and a sheet of paper, and you had to go so many feet this way, turn northwest, go so many feet, and they would see if you found your way back to a spot that they had marked if you had done it accurately. And so you had to walk off the feet. That was great. One time we hiked. You had to take one day where you actually hike outside of camp for 2 miles, at least 2 miles. You made your own campfire. You did your own cooking. All this was required. I learned as a young scout that when you make a campfire and you put your pot, my bean soup, I made bean soup, you put your pot on top, and you try to get your flame higher, don't blow on the flame if you got pine needles all around it. I've eaten a lot of bean soup with pine needles in it. We went out into the forest carrying our jugs of water, carrying our backpacks, carrying our tents, and there was a large storm. I mean, it's a heavy rain. The scoutmaster is the only one that dug a trench around his tent. I remember waking up with water all over me. I wasn't the only one. A lot of scouts never dug the trench. We ended up walking up the road a little bit and found an old sawmill. And in this sawmill, we slept on the tables that were in there. The next day in camp, I remember a guy named John Foster. This is a John Foster that is about my age. He lived at the very end of Carey's Run. He's walking around with a big blanket around him, along with a couple buddies. Wanted to know if we had seen any of their clothes. Apparently, they camped in a dry river, creek bank, creek bed, okay? And there was enough water that washed all their things away. So those are my memories of Camp Oyo. Next, we move on up and we have Roosevelt Lake. In 1969, who has gone to the trout derbies? I went to a trout derby in 1969. A whole bunch of West Siders were camping right when you pull into Roosevelt Lake up on the lakeside. Off to the left, we put tents there. Myself and a guy named Steve Sekuli took a little walk. I never hung out with Steve that much. He's a year older than me, but we just happened to be together that day. We met two girls from the city of Portsmouth. City girls. One was a brunette, one was a tall blonde. We just walked around with them for about a half hour and then said goodbye. That was that. 1969, that summer, trout derby's about what, April? Mm-hmm. And so That summer, I went to a swim dance at Dreamland Pool. Who's attended swim dances at Dreamland? You know, we've got a lot of old people here today. So I went to a swim dance, and I'm standing there, and there's this tall, beautiful blonde that comes up and says, "Hi, is your name Butch Stahl?" I said, "Yeah, who are you?" And she says, "I don't know if you remember me. We met at the Trout Derby." And then she pointed to the brunette who I was with. And I said, "Oh, yeah, I remember you now." The brunette was with her boyfriend. I noticed that right off. The tall blonde, I said, "Are you with anybody?" She said, "No." And I said, "Would you like to dance?" So we danced. And then she said, "Well, I have to leave. My dad's here to pick me up." I walked her to the car. Stupid Carrie's runner. I didn't ask for her name, her last name. I didn't ask for her phone number. I didn't ask where she lived. You got to remember, we didn't have cell phones then. And it was like, she's going to disappear from my life. But being the bold girl she is, she says, "Would you like to come to my house sometime?" I said, "Wow, that's great." I went to her house the next night. Now, more on that story in just a little bit. Let's move on up to Turkey Creek Lake. That's what they call a cliffhanger, okay? Now, at Turkey Creek Lake in 1967, I was working for Roy McGovney Construction. I was in high school, and it was a good summer job. You know, in 1967, I think I made $1.25 or $1.50 an hour. That was big money. And I just have a couple things I want to say about Turkey Creek Lake. My dad also worked for McGovney Construction at the time. He was like a superintendent, but the man over us was Orville Ferguson. Does anyone remember Orville? What a great guy. And Orville would come and check on us from time to time. But at Turkey Creek Lake, these are some of the things I remember. Before it was actually built, I would go with my dad. And right at this opening, when you come across 125, there used to be a drive that come down, and you crossed a bridge to go to the park manager's house. His name is Don Sweeney. You remember Don Sweeney? Yeah. And I couldn't remember his name the other day. Then Don Sweeney, and there used to be just past the where the beach area is, in that area, there was a brick house there. And that's where Don Sweeney lived. And we would visit him. And then they began construction on this. And these are just a couple things I remember about the, I remember the cross ties. You know where the parking lot is? They have concrete ties. They used to have old creosote ties that we put for parking blocks. I hated that job because they had long steel rods you had to pound down into the hard ground, and I would try to avoid that with as much as I could. We did all the asphalt work here. We had a road grader that my great uncle Sherman Brooks ran. I hated road graders because I was the guy that had to do all the grease fittings at the end of the day. They have more grease fittings than any other piece of heavy equipment. And we would enjoy lunch under the pine trees, you know, down where the nature center is. We would go up under those pine trees. It was a highlight of my days eating lunch. My mom would always pack two bologna sandwiches, some pork and beans, and we would sit there and enjoy the cool breeze. I also had to keep track of the amount of stone that was being delivered. As they were building these roads up through here, we had stone that would come in and be delivered. I would take their ticket, initial it, give them a copy, keep one. At the end of the day, we would total that up so we would know how much that to pay for the amount of stone. So when you first turn off 125, coming into the lodge, right off to your left, there's a little picnic grove right there. I would guess that I probably have stood in that location longer than anybody in history. Because I was there every day collecting that in the hot sun, and those pines there, they don't provide a lot of shade. Another memory I had is, at the end of the day, a college student worked with us named Steve Reisner. Steve Reisner had a Corvette, and he would take me home. And we'd go down 52, like 100 miles an hour. It was the most exciting part of the day. Okay, now we're going to move on up. Any questions about Turkey Creek Lake or anything? We hauled sand in. You know, in here it says I helped build this. I was just a labor, okay? When we did the asphalt, I was the guy that carried the torch. Because when you do asphalt work, you got to keep those shovels nice and hot. And so when they throw the asphalt out, when they rake it, you got to keep the rakes hot. And I carried this big old torch around, always melting off the asphalt that had gotten cold, so they had good hot equipment. My memories of Turkey Creek Lake.
Well, I have a question.
Okay, question from Esther.
How deep are the lakes? Because they dredged those, and they didn't look very deep.
I'll let Jenny answer that.
I don't know how deep they would have been originally, but they're not very deep anymore because all man-made lakes fill in with leaf litter and things, so they have to be dredged every so often. We only have one dredge crew, so they don't get dredged very often. So I'd say probably the deepest spot in that lake is 20 to 25 feet. I'm not 100% sure on that. I've never put on any equipment and dove down with a measuring stick or anything.
I wanted to walk it when I saw them dredged, but I didn't do that. But they did just look shallow for me.
I felt like they were pretty deep when I was when we built the levee and put the parking area in. I ran the roller to roll back and forth that stone. My great uncle did the grader to grade it out, and back and forth. And every time I would come back to where the boat landing is there, I'd be so afraid that the brakes aren't going to go out. And I would get up as close as I could, but I'd be scared to death that big old roller was not going to stop. I'd hurry up and reverse it so I could go back. My great uncle got me on the grader once and said, "Here, you can run this." So he's sitting with me. They have several brakes. They're all over the place. And as we headed towards the lake, it wouldn't stop for me. And he just sat there and laughed. And I thought, "Are you crazy?" And I kept pushing on that, and I wasn't very big, and I pushing, and finally he helped me stop it. But that's another memory I had. What made me think of that is we were going to go into the lake. Now, who remembers the A-frames that sit just over the hill here before the lodge was built? You remember the A-frames? You remember it, Chris? Pardon me? Yeah, there were a couple of them there. Those were owned by Bud and Tom Reiser, okay? And they owned this property before the state come in. This was called High Meadow, and there was a pond back here on the back. Now, why is that important in my memory? You remember the tall blonde that I met at Dreamland Pool? So, in 1969, I had graduated from high school. Now, I don't mean this to brag, but I was on the National Honor Society at West, one of only two boys. And I was invited back for our annual picnic after I graduated. Bud Reiser was our guidance counselor, and he would have a little picnic at those A-frames and give us a hayride. And we would take the wagon, drive out on the roads here and come up on the meadow. It was just really nice. But that tall blonde that I met at Dreamland Pool, this is the first official date that I took her on. And I brought her here to go on this wagon ride and meet all of my classmates, the people I'd gone to school with. That was in 1969. And believe it or not, that tall blonde, she's here with me still today. And her name was Lynn Hughes. And we married in 1973, which is 50 years ago. And the lodge opened on June 14th, 1973, 50 years ago. So you see how all this comes together for a guy like Butch Stahl. And right now, if you turn, I'm going to ask that tall blonde to stand up. She's back here in the back. There she is. The city girl that has corrected my language and asked me out.
Got you sophisticated.
And made me sophisticated, if you can say I'm sophisticated. So I think it's just amazing that here we are 50 years later at a location where I took my wife, you know, on our first date. And when I look at this lodge and look at this property, I see it differently than most people because all those memories rush through my head. And it was a wonderful time. So let's see, we covered the tall blonde. I'm glad I ended up with her instead of the brunette, okay? One other thing I had to say about the A-frames. Do you know that one of those A-frames still exists today? Who knows where that A-frame is?
What?
It's the Nature Center, correct. And so if you want to see the A-frames that used to sit here, go to the other end of the lake, and that's the Nature Center. That is one of the A-frames.
I have one of the original brochures from High Meadows because I had the fellas come up and tell a Shawnee story about their business that they had back in the late 60s and early 70s, and they had their original brochures, and I said, oh, I've got to have one of those. So I laminated a couple, and they're hanging up on the wall there, and I tell everybody the story because I think it's an amazing thing that I still have a little piece of that. You know, it's still part of our history, but the A-frame. I hope we always have it here.
That's neat. I didn't know that you had something like
yeah.
that. Okay, now we're going to get, for the real reason you're here, the video. As I might have said earlier, it's the only video that I know that exists. And it has some music that's gone with it. It's an 8mm film. My dad had it transferred to a VHS tape. Later we had the VHS tape to a DVD, the DVD to a digital format that's out there in a cloud. This, I hope you can see it okay. And what I'm going to do is, this video lasts, I think, 30 minutes or less. All right. I'm just going to pause it during parts of the video and then explain what's going on. For a lot of people, if you're not in construction, you might find it kind of boring because it's a lot of heavy equipment. But I'm going to try to explain exactly what we are doing as we go through the video. And I'll get this fired up now. And
can I tell a story about the Trump Derby first?
Oh, sure.
Okay. Can you hear me back from the back? Trout Derby. My wife and I came out to a trout derby one time, and we went out there, and there was, I don't remember all the stuff about it, but there was this hole, there must be 20 people around this hole, you're doing this, not catching anything. Everybody just, anyway, this guy came up, he had the suit on, had the little pouch on the side, the hat, he went up there and stood, reached into a little bag, took out a couple of lures, and went, poof. Pulled one out, second time, put it back in the bag, and walked off. Half the people around that thing just dead at that point.
Well, and I have a couple pictures back here are from the Trout Derby, and one of them you can see some of the campers, and you can tell it was during that time period. Next, it's a matter of getting the TV to turn on, okay? That's my dad. Okay, so my dad's Estel Stahl, and he was quoted in the article in the first on that when the tree was going down. It said Estel Stahl had the contract to remove dirt and to build this bench out here. And I'm going to explain how this bench was built, or that the lodge sits on. This is a picture of Dad right before he passed, and I have a picture back there. Many of you probably know Estel Stahl. But I paused it here because I want to ask, who knows who this person is?
You?
It's not me. This is Rick Campbell. You know the attorney Rick Campbell? In town. Rick's about in the seventh grade here. And with him, his buddy, we think it's Bob Root, or, yeah, I think it's Bob Rudity. You see this fellow here? How many of you know who that is? He was a superintendent on the job, and his name's Roger Thornberry. You know, the people that's in this video, there's only like four or five that are still alive today. Myself, a guy named Virgil Breach, Rick Campbell, and Roger Thornberry. I really think it's neat that Roger's able to join us today. Roger, stand up. Oh, he said it's not that easy.
My old back has about had it.
So, Roger.
I'm not the talker this man is. So, he takes after his dad. I've done a lot of listening.
So, Roger was a young fellow. My dad was only in his early 40s when he did this job.
I was 27.
Roger was 27 years old. And so I just think it's great that as we talk about the lodge being built 50 years ago, that Roger's able to be here. Roger lives in Adams County in West Union, so he didn't have the long trip. And I'm going to ask for his input on some of these. He didn't know that. And so I might be surprised with his answer as well, okay?
Get a lot out of it.
Okay, well, we're going to ask you to explain some things here.
The old Jeep there was mine, that old green Jeep.
The green Jeep was Roger's.
That was the first thing to come up here. And my son was with me. That was him, little.
Okay.
He's 58 now.
So we have maybe five or six people still living. Yeah. Right?
Yeah.
Does this bring back a lot of memories for you?
Yeah, I think about it a lot.
Well, I want you to explain to them, just stay right there, because I'm going to play something here. I want you to explain what this is. Okay, so this is a pan that's being pulled by a dozer. Some people call them earth movers. Later, they weren't pulled by a dozer. They're called a turnip pole. So these are some different names. But that's an old pan. Do you have anything to comment or explain on that?
Old cable scraper.
Cable scraper.
Yeah. And that dozer was a new 16-house Chalmers dozer.
Yeah, we were so proud of that dozer. Yeah.
Yeah, that's probably the quickest piece of equipment he had up until that time.
Now, the first people on this job was myself and my great uncle, Sherman Brooks. And Sherman would tell me that it's a poor day when an operator has to get down off his dozer to help a labor. Now, why would he say that to me? Because as we were pushing the brush and gathering it together, he'd say, Butch, I want you to put a chain around that, tie it up, and then he would pull it away. The problem is, whenever I would tie it together, he would pull off and the chain would go and all the brush would still sit here. And so he would get off and say, shake his head, and I thought, oh man, I'm in trouble now. And he'd say, it's really a bad day when an operator's got to get off his equipment to help a laborer. And so what he would do is show me how to tie a slip knot so that when the dozer pulled away, it would pull up tight. And I learned a lot in my day working with these folks. Here we go. It moves pretty fast. What's significant about that? We are working at night. This job had to get done. I noticed some early projections said it would be open in June of 1972. It opened in January of 1973. So must have run behind schedule somewhere along the line. But we were working at nighttime to get this thing done. I love the music. All right, I think we're going to make it. Okay, question is, where did the electricity come from? Generators. Yeah. This is my uncle, my dad's stepbrother, Ron Shinsis. He was a foreman on the job. He worked for Dad for many years, and you could always go and get in Ronnie's truck, and he would warm you up with coffee and a good heater. But Ronnie was always on the job, and Ronnie just passed a few years ago. His brother, I'm going to be visiting him next week. He lives down in Florida, Kenny Shinsis. Does anyone know this person?
Earl Pritchard
from Arion Road. Earl was an old farmer and the hardest worker I've ever worked with. He never quit.
My sister up there, Carol, right there, she used to work in the office over there and she knew Earl.
Oh, you do?
Yeah, I'm not
sure. Carol, you didn't know?
No.
Well, you do now.
Good to meet you.
She's the mouth.
Well, Earl, just a piece of information. He lived on Arion Road. How many of you know where the Rumpke landfill is? So they had a farm. The Pritchard farm was there, and they helped raise my dad. Dad was he was an only child, and my grandmother worked. My grandfather was a farmer, so when he was really little, Dad would stay with the Pritchards, knew them really well. Later in life, Dad bought that farm, And the Pritchard Farm, he developed a landfill there. And so we developed a landfill, and in 1980, Dad had a heart attack, so he wasn't going to be able to do a lot of things he used to do. And so I sold the landfill and the farm to a company. I contacted a company called Gerbus Brothers Construction out of Cincinnati. And they also had, I said, would you be interested in buying a Cat 941 front end loader? They said, well, what are you using it for? I said, we use it to backfill, and we have an open ditch trench method for a landfill, and we use it to backfill. They said, oh, we'd be interested in the landfill. I said, oh, okay. So we sold the landfill to a company called Waste Away. They owned a company, Waste Away. They come in, and we did mostly, I had a trash business, mostly commercial, and we sold everything to them. They developed that to be pretty good size, and then they sold it to Rumpke. And now you know the rest of the story, where Rumpke come from. It started with our landfill out on Arion Road, and it goes all the way back to the Pritchard Farm. So you see the hose here? What's going on? There used to be a pond back here in the back, and we're draining that pond and backfilling it. My brother and I worked here. I was going to college at the time. We each had our own dump truck that we were given, and we would haul dirt. So the dirt had to be taken out of here, moved to the back, we'd fill up the pond, and then we brought dirt back here. And I'll explain how we cut this bench out here in just a little bit. So that's a pond that you set up. You know where the tennis courts are back that way? Used to be a pond there. Okay, we're starting to build this bench. You see the lake in the background? I just tell you that so you can have a perspective of where we are, okay? Now, if you notice, the dozer's down at a tree level. It's at the trunk level. And they're cutting into the side of the hill right now, and they're digging out into this bank here to build up this bench that we're talking about. And you'll see that come up here in just a little bit. Thank you. This is Clyde Littoral, and he's from Otway, and he's running, I believe that is could be the Cat 941 front end loader. This is the front end loader that I was trying to sell that ended up selling the farm and the landfill, okay? These all tie together. And Clyde Littoral was a great operator. What we're doing right now, they're hauling dirt, filling up dirt in order to for us to load them, take them back, and fill in the pond. One of the problems with that my brother and I had is that we felt we would always race to see who could get the most loads of dirt in one day. And so we would come down, they would load it, and off we would go, and then we would dump our load without even stopping. Raise the tailgate up and just take off and just come on back. When we'd come back, they said, you guys have got to slow down because you're carrying half your load back with you. And it's because it wasn't all empty. And so got in trouble for that also. But this is how young people learn, right?
Who was to give you the hard time?
Who would give? Uncle Sherman.
There you go.
Yeah. Does anyone know who this is? Let me play it a little bit further. Ah, you missed it. I'll back it up, if I can.
Is he a riser?
No.
He's either Buster or you.
Oh, no. Now we got to fast forward. Should have never done that. Does it fast forward? Yeah. Here we go. We're moving now. If there was anything that you missed in the first part of this video, you might catch it here as we fast forward.
Was the soil real full of a lot of clay, or was it pretty movable?
I mean, it was movable. The reason you see all that smoke coming up is because it's really cold and the soil's still warm. That's why you see that coming up. The other thing is that you got to realize you're asking someone who was just in college. I didn't care about any of that stuff. I didn't even pay attention to those things.
I'm just wondering about the site selection with 60,000 acres, or maybe not that many at that time, but how was it determined to build a lodge here because of the overlook of the lake?
I wouldn't know about the site selection. Let's see. But I do know that the risers were not interested in selling it at the time, and so but the state said this is where they felt like it should be.
So it was eminent domain.
Eminent domain is how they, but they did sell it.
It was on account of the lake.
Pardon me.
The lake is what they would want.
The lake is that's what they were after, the view there.
That's the reason they shoved it out here on the nose.
I think we're back. Okay, here we go. We're going to try to identify this person one more time. Go a little further. Okay, this guy right here is yours truly. So, what happened though, over the years, my teeth actually come together, okay? In 1971, I still had a part in my teeth. So anyway, that's me dressed really warm, smiling because I'm on camera, I guess. Now we've got some new pans in here. Notice that? So Blazer Construction actually did the parking lots. Dad had to do this bench that we built. But Blazer did the parking lot. And we have some new equipment on site now. These are a lot nicer. Do you know where we are right now? Can you see the... Because this crown back here of trees still exists today. It looks just like that. So if you look back towards the parking lot, that's what you're looking at. Right, the access. And here you see the very first footers for this lodge, stone being put into the first footers. Altman Cody, they're the folks with the orange hats on. And this is my uncle, John Foster, a different John Foster than we talked about at Camp Oyo. He lived on Carey's Run, married my mother's sister, Polly. So you wonder, what in the world's going on here? You have a truck that's smoking like that, and that was my truck. So what would cause a truck to smoke like that?
Burning oil.
Not burning oil.
Burning rubber.
Not burning rubber.
Radiator problem.
Not the radiator.
Getting wet underneath.
No. When you run out of gas, you go and you get more fuel out of the tool shed. So I grabbed a 5-gallon, what I thought was gasoline. It was fuel oil. Okay, it was diesel for the dozer. And I poured that in there, and another problem, okay? You know, all these things, Dad never said anything to me about it. You know, what a father to have, right? I don't know if it ruined the engine or not. I went on to college. Now you know why I went to college, right? Yeah, it was a smoky mess. Oh, this is really interesting. So Earl, the hardest worker in the world. Roger, the superintendent. It's the first time I saw him do any work on this job. This is the reason Dad videoed this. He wanted to capture this. So, Roger Thornberry, everybody, a round of applause.
That's good old days.
Look at him work. So this is my dad. He's running the Cat 941 front end loader. It has a 4-in-1 bucket. And he's talking to Virgil Breach and Earl Pritchard. And what he's telling them, guys, make sure you tamp around those trees really well, because we have to preserve them. We don't want the job shutting down again. Make sure you're doing a good job to tamp around those trees. This is the first time I've seen it. I think that is Dwayne Cooper. And Dwayne Cooper ran the fuel oil truck. He's from out at, was it Otway or Raritan?
Raritan.
First time I've seen that.
Virgil Breach.
Yeah, this is Virgil Breach right here. My dad, Earl Pritchard. And that is called a tamper. It vibrates and tamps. It's very heavy. I always tried to avoid that thing.
Talk about me.
Notice the tape, red tape, around the tree. It's important, so we're trying to save that tree. That's one of them. The question is that tree still there? That's a good question. On the side for landscaping. I think you're right. And that's Dad's fuel oil truck. It was always ran by Dwayne Cooper. He used to deliver fuel oil through the county. Now, this is called a sheep foot. And what we were doing, we cut this bank back, had to cut into the side of the hill. Then we had to bring dirt back in and put it in small layers and then compact it in. We would take this sheep foot, run it back and forth to make sure it's well compacted. We had a geologist here from Cincinnati who would inspect our work each day. As we built this bench and brought it up, which is where the pool is and all, that's why you're looking at the top of these trees instead of at the bottom. It sits on a bench. I think we did a really good job, because 50 years later, here we sit and the hillside hasn't slipped.
What's that machine called? I couldn't really hear
you. It's called a sheep foot.
Sheep, like the animal sheep?
Yes. Sheep. Am I right, Roger? Oh, then I... And this is the water truck, the blue tank. Now, why would we have that on the site? Anybody know?
Keep dust down.
Keep dust down. So we'd have to keep the soil wet so it's not a dusty environment. This is my brother, Buster. He passed away in 1984, leukemia. I have looked for years for videos of him. The only video I have is right before he passed in the hospital. And here we have him. So this lodge video is really important because it's the only video of my brother.
He was a good guy.
He wasn't as good looking as me. This is Jack Flack from out in McDermott area. Worked for Dad for many years. Roger Thornsberry, Earl Pritchard. We talked about Earl Pritchard. When he ate lunch, he always drank two Dr. Peppers with his lunch every day. The only guy I ever saw loved Dr. Pepper. This is my dad running some of the new equipment. While we're eating lunch, he's out playing on the equipment and working on his suntan. Can you believe that on a state job, we're not wearing shirts and working on our tan? It wouldn't happen today. Apparently it's Roger's Jeep. Looks like a rough ride. Apparently he's an inspector. I really don't know who he is, but he's probably an inspector coming to check the job out. We're getting ready to pour footers. Pardon me?
What's our elevation here? The elevation.
Now you got to remember, I was a college kid. I'm just showing you the video.
I think the plan had 500.
Oh, Roger says he thinks the plan had about 500.
Okay.
Out on Arion Road, my dad had a farm out there, and it was around 900, eight. It was the highest elevation out in that area. So
that says we're at 970 feet here.
Oh, 970 feet. There we go.
Probably not totally accurate.
Yeah.
Somewhat.
Thank you, Miss Jenny.
Guess I didn't know what I was
talking about. So, Roger, he's from Adams County. So. And this is the tail end of the video. We're nearing the very end right now. For those that have to go to the restroom. So this is the access road. As you come around the bottom here by the lake parking lot here in the beach area and come up around the side, another contractor had that, and they had to bust up all the rock. You can see how they're doing it. You also see here where the big pans are moving and getting dirt, but it's so rough they have a dozer pushing the pan in order to make his load. These dozers also have what they call a ripper on the back, rips up the rock. All right, so that's what's going on in this next part of the video. That's the ripper.
Is
And now you're witnessing the very first, some of the first concrete that was poured into the footers here. And I believe it is furnished by McGovney Ready Mix. Can you see the parking lot back there taking shape in the back part? Now what this fellow's doing is what they call a slump test. So he's checking to see what the consistency of the concrete is, and it does it check out before they proceed with any more work. This hose, it's a vibrator, and they put down in to remove any air pockets and then help equally distribute the concrete. Pardon me?
You left the college during part of this.
Do what?
You were off to college during part of this construction.
Yeah, I was going to college, and I work here, you know, like if I got an F in calculus and I need to drop everything the next quarter and just study on one, I worked and studied on that one course. So that's how I got through school. Pardon me?
Did you go to the college of the branch down here?
Yes, Portsmouth Branch.
So did I.
Yeah. 1969, 70, 71. Then I went to Ohio University up on Athens.
Same here.
You know, I've been wanting to do this for so many years, and I'm so happy that all of you come to witness some of our history here at the lodge And if you live in this area, I'm sure you can identify with a lot of memories here. Again, if you have any videos of this lodge being built or any early videos, Jenny, Lisa, they would love to have them. If you have any pictures, because it's very difficult to find that. This is the only video that we know that exists of the lodge being built. And we've been wanting to do this for many years. Are there any questions before we close? By the way, an hour and 25 minutes so far. Yes, back here.
Would you, is the video posted on YouTube?
No, it's not.
No, because some of my family might be interested. I just looked at Kinkle. My family had their reunions here quite a few times.
Uh-huh.
And some of my relatives.
Well, here's what we're doing right now. And so we have the folks back here videoing this. And what they're going to do is they're going to show the actual video with my voiceover. It won't mean a lot unless there's some narration with it. And so they're going to do some editing, and then that's going to be available down here at the lodge. Donnie's going to do one for me as well. And so I hope to take that and probably put that out there on YouTube.
I'm sure we'll also have that on YouTube and social media as well.
Okay, so.
It would be great if we could have, we could post a link to our Shawnee State Park and Shawnee State Park Lodge pages when the videos are finished, so that everyone has access to click on it and watch it.
Esther?
I have an OSHA question. Was anyone injured in the making of this film?
Was anybody injured in making of the film? I don't think so. I've never heard of any injuries, you know.
Now, it opened in January 73. What was the initial date it started?
Well, I believe I was trying to figure out when. Do you know when we did this, Roger? Was it 71?
I think we started in 70.
In 70?
I believe in January.
So it's 70, 71 time frame. And that makes sense because by 72, I wasn't here. I was in Athens, I think. And so for me to be in this video, we're talking about that time frame.
So about 3 years.
Yes?
These two here in their 40s, on their Sunday afternoon, we couldn't drive up. We had to park down there and hike up, just to see what was going on.
Oh, so you would come to watch the activity here?
Yes.
And you had, we had a road to just come up over the front here. That's the only way you could get up here.
And we would park and hike up.
Oh.
And it was rough.
And you're here today because you're still nosy, wanting to know what's going on, right? Chris.
People do not know there are, and I'm sure it's in all the brochures, but there are 50 rooms here. 25 cabins, and I was fortunate to have a couple of contracts here. We painted where the canoe hangs on the wall from the third floor down to the pool, and we painted one section over the pool that we had to have scaffolding and water picks there in 1990 and 1991.
Well, I'm glad you mentioned that because it made me remember too that we have cabins out here, and I read in the newspaper, I was shocked that the cabins were built. I thought they come later, but I think they were actually built about the same time or before the lodge was completed. They were completed before?
We done the dirt work on them.
Okay, because I remember...
Not much dirt work.
Yeah.
Just a very little.
So we had the cabins, and I worked on that because the little sidewalks that go into the cabin from the main road, we had to shovel off, and when we put asphalt on that, I learned really quick when you're on top of in a dump truck on hot asphalt, don't wear tennis shoes that day, okay? You do not wear tennis shoes, but we would shovel that down in there and work all that out by hand.
Initially, all the water supply was on the outside of those cabins, and we changed a couple of them to where the water supply was inside so they could be used year-round. I imagine they all are by this time.
Okay.
You remember Clayton Cable?
Stand up.
Well,
Clayton Cable. He has also worked for my dad, a really good friend of the family.
He lived over there.
Right.
But I worked him too hard here.
Well, I noticed he's not on the video.
Well, he was older. But what I'm saying was he never sweat.
Yeah.
He did not sweat. And I worked
he said it, he'd come to me out here. We was wheeling asphalt down over in there in the tennis court or something.
Mm-hmm.
He said, Roger, he said, you're working me too hard. He said, I was sweating. I thought he was sick. He said, I got one drop of sweat right there. And it was on the end of his nose. That's the only time I ever seen him sweat.
Well, I've never heard Clayton ever say he'd work too hard because I never keep up with him. Wow.
He was a good one.
He was. Any other questions?
Yeah.
Comments?
I was wondering, did you come to like the grand opening? Like there was dignitaries here and you?
I don't remember it.
You didn't attend it? Because there should be a film of that, right? In the state archives or something? They probably should have.
I would think.
Like the governor was probably here, you know.
I don't know. Anybody else?
Yes, if this is comment section. He didn't want me to do it, but my old buddy back here, Mike Sissel, you know, Sissel Loggers, he said his family, he was one of them that would get your logs here and go saw them up at the sawmill down the road here.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. Oh, Mike Sissel.
Yeah, and some of these logs actually, some of the timber here, I thought, come from Georgia or somewhere, too. We didn't mention there. Back in the back, Drew Feit was able to find some articles from the Portsmouth Times. I put them back there. And one of them showed them actually painting Raven Rock here. And it's a picture of them actually doing the painting of that mural there. Jenny, I'm turning it over to you.
Thank you very much. That was wonderful.
Thank you.
Thoughts of who might tell a good Shawnee story, let me know, and we'll make it happen.